Hello, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. In the previous video of this mini-series, I made an assessment of this image. My intention is to convert it to black and white, but first I need to process it from the RAW file into an image I can edit. Now I've opened the RAW file already in Affinity Photo, and it's switched into the develop persona automatically, which is what happens. You can see the unadjusted RAW file on the screen now, and the first thing you'll notice is that it's greatly overexposed. This is because I was exposing to the right when I shot the image. This means I overexposed slightly in order to open up the shadows, and that will give me a better quality image in those shadows. The only problem is that you tend to blow out the highlights, but in this case I don't mind this because I like it to draw the eye up into this top right hand corner where the brightest areas are. But back to the correction, and let's start by adjusting the exposure. Now I'm just drawing the exposure down so that I make a recovery, not just in these bright areas, but it darkens the image down slightly as well. The other area where we had a problem with this image was the low contrast, so I'm just going to increase the contrast slightly, and that's created a more saturated, contrasty image. Now I've possibly overdone the exposure reduction, so I'm just going to increase that slightly. And the other thing I'll do is use the shadows and highlights to try to recover some of these areas. So if I use this highlight slider, you can see the effect it's having on the highlights. Now, I don't really want to recover them too much because I still want it to be very light in that corner. But I do want to make sure I've opened up the shadows sufficiently. The other thing I'm going to do whilst I'm in the develop persona is just select the profile that I want to use. So rather than the sRGB profile, I'm going to be editing this image in the Adobe RGB profile. If I switch now to the lens tab, you'll see that I have the lens corrections on, and I also have chromatic aberration reduction switched on as well. Now those come on as defaults in the develop persona. The other area that I want to look at is the detail, and I want to make sure that I sharpen the foreground image sufficiently. So let's switch into detail, and I'm going to zoom in my image now to 100%. I'll find the area that I want to focus on for sharpening, and now I'll apply a detail refinement to adjust the sharpness of the image. So I'm going to use a fairly low radius, and I'm just going to push the amount up until I see a good effect here, which is what we're getting at the moment. Now I'll just go to the top right hand side of the image and make sure that we're not causing noise to occur in these trees. And we're not, that looks quite clean. Now looking at the image, it's still quite a green and blue image. Now I'm just going to go back to the basic panel. Now one of the things you should do when you're converting to black and white is make sure you've got the right colour balance and the right definition in the image so that when it gets converted you'll get separation. So I'm just going to go back to the white balance now, and I'm going to actually increase the colour temperature very slightly there. And I'm going to reduce the level of pink tint in this. And that looks about right. What it should give me is some separation between the stones and the foliage once I convert to black and white. I'm now going to go over to tones, and one of the things that you'll probably see is this black and white conversion. I'm not going to use the black and white conversion here. Instead, I'm going to use silver effects later. The reason I do that is that I find I've got much greater control with NIC Silver Effects Pro than I do with the black and white converter. Also, if I apply the black and white conversion as part of the RAW conversion, it gets baked into the image. I don't have the opportunity to redo it later. What I can do though is use it to check the response. So here we can see the response on the stones by moving the blue slider left and right, and also on the cyan slider. If I move the greens, you'll see that I can darken or lighten areas, and the yellows should do the same. There we are. so it gives me some idea of how the image will respond when I do convert it, so it's worthwhile still taking a look at this. The other thing that we can use is the curve, and I always like to use the curves even though you've got similar adjustments under the basic panel here. I find that using the curves just adds that little bit of snap and colour back into the image. So I'll just adjust that, and that's given me a nice feeling of shade in this area, whilst the highlights here are still quite light. Now the other thing I could have done is used an overlay here. So if we just go to overlays, you'll see that I'm working on the master at the moment. Now all overlays do are make selections that you can then adjust separately. So if you're used to working in something like Adobe Lightroom, you'll be familiar with the graduated adjustment, and you can do a similar thing actually in Affinity Photo. If I go over here and select the graduate tool, I can now draw a selection. So here I'm selecting the highlight area. Now I can go back to the basic panel and I can actually use some of these adjustments. So if we use the highlights here, I can increase the highlights or reduce them just in that area. And again, I can open up my shadows or reduce them, although there isn't much shadow in that area. And I can also adjust my brightness in that area or reduce it. And I quite like the look I'm getting there. I'll go back to the overlay panel again. I'll make another selection here on the master. And I'll use again the same adjustment to select the foreground. This time I'll go back to the basic panel and I can apply my contrast, so I can increase the contrast or reduce it in these areas. And also I can adjust the shadows to open them just slightly. Now you'll notice that not all the adjustments are available, such as clarity. If we want to adjust the clarity in this image, we'd need to go back, select the master, and then we can adjust the clarity. So there we can add in some clarity to really make these rocks pop. And again, I'm now going to lighten that area just slightly and also open up the shadows just that little bit further. The final overlay that I'm going to use is actually a radial or an elliptical adjustment. So here I'm now going to draw the ellipse that I want to select. And what I'm doing is I'm trying to make a selection of the millstones. And what that's going to allow me to do is actually lighten those millstones very slightly. All I'm doing here is just darkening the black point just to add a little bit more snap into that area. And I could increase the brightness as well. And I can reduce or increase the contrast, and that's just to make them stand out a little bit further. I'm now reasonably satisfied with the adjustment that I've got. I just go back to the overlay, select the master, and let's have a look at the original image. There you can see the original on the right, and there we've got the much more contrasty image on the left. You can also look at them side by side. So I'm happy now with the new adjusted image. That, although it looks quite crunchy and contrasty, it should make for a very good black and white conversion. One of the things I find is that the black and white conversion seems to suck the contrast out of a lot of images. So sometimes it's better to have more contrast at the start and a greater degree of saturation in order to create the right response in the image when you convert it. In the next video, I'll look at how we can convert the image using Nick Silver Effects Pro. I'm Robin Whalley. You've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you in the next video. Thank you.